the streets of Kampala and just in the country as a whole is, do we need these GMOs? Are they safe for us? So for us to break that down, I brought for you Dr. Joseph Okia. He is a specialist physician of human medicine, and also he is from the Uganda Medical Association. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Next to him is Mr. Klet Wandui Masiga. He is a bioscience innovation director at the Tropical Institute of Development Innovations. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Let's talk about GMOs, and I'll start with you, Mr. Klet. Are they safe for us? Of course, you being an innovator, being a pro-GMO, actually you have developed GMOs such as, you know, maize for drought, you know, tolerance. Are they safe for us? Let's start from that. Why should we move towards accepting GMOs?
GMOs are the safest food, or the products from GMO crops and livestock are the safest, because it's the only products that are highly regulated and they go through safety assessments before human consumption. So several studies have been sanctioned, including those by the European Union, the National Academies of Science, the medical associations globally, and the World Trade Organization, and all of them have come to one single thing. GMOs are very, very safe. There is no single incidence where GMOs have been found not to be safe to humans, biodiversity, and the environment.
Okay, simply break it down. What is a GMO? Of course, it's a genetically modified organism, but how does it work? In a nutshell, break it down for us in a very simplistic way, because you just say GMOs, GMOs, and most of us don't understand what exactly it is.
These are products that come as a result of a process which involves movement of genes from one organism to another, and in most cases those organisms that may not naturally be able to cross or mate and produce a fertile individual. So it involves, you know, in nature there is a barrier. Mm-hmm. For example, a human can only mate with a human. Maize can only cross with maize. Wheat can only cross with wheat to give a new variety. And the cow can cross with another cow to give another cow. And through that process, you get a new breed of cattle. Now, with genetic engineering, you can actually pick a gene from, say, sorghum and put that gene into maize. Mm-hmm. And this is done for a specific reason or a purpose that you are looking to solve. For example, we are now looking at maize for drought tolerance. Now, most of the genes for drought tolerance have been actually identified from a model plant called Aldopsis, which belongs to the category of the family of plants that have cabbages, sukuma wheat, and others. So that being a model plant, it just takes a maximum of 30 days to get seed to seed. Mm-hmm. So it has been a subject of high scientific studies, understanding the genes and how they work.
All right.
Then we have also some other plants that we have identified some useful genes from, using now the current field of genomics.
Okay. Dr. Okia, from Mr. Klett's explanation, it pretty much seems harmless. So why are doctors against this?
I think we are all scientists, and we all use science to come to some conclusions. I can state that according to our research and from a medical perspective, these GMOs are not safe. You are messing up with DNA, and manipulating DNA is a very dangerous thing. There are many diseases that are caused just by one gene being changed. For example, Down syndrome is one gene that has been changed, and the result is a human being who has less function, who has greater disability. We also have researches where people were feeding these GMOs to different animals, yes, and so many health problems came to those animals. Mm-hmm. We have issues with infertility, allergies, yes. So it is very dangerous to stand and say these GMOs are safe. They're not safe. And the interesting thing is we've been here before, yes. The tobacco industry used to say smoking is safe, it does not cause cancer, yes. And they hired scientists to make studies and studies showing that smoking is safe. But we kept saying, according to what we see with our patients, smoking is not safe, it causes cancer. And this is the same with GMOs. At the end of the day, we're seeing a rise in heart disease, a rise in diabetes, a rise in high blood pressure. And we're saying there is something connected to food, yes? And therefore, we must protect food more than anything else. We cannot allow food to be experimented on. And if my colleagues, the scientists, were willing to enter into the science, let's do an experiment. Let's get some volunteers. We feed them GMOs. We get these other people. We feed them our local chicken. Yes. And we follow them. And you'll see.
All right. Okay. Of course, we'll come to you. And so you can just break it down, the relation between this GMOs and the human body. Maybe you can just take one example and then break it down for us. But in 2017, when this actually became a phenomenon and a story that hit the headlines, we saw scientists who are pro-GMOs come out very strongly to defend it. So let's take a look.
If he is concerned about patent, we have a patent law. The patent law deals with it. If he is concerned about indigenous things, create an appropriate law, deal with it. But don't block the science for reasons that have nothing to do with the science. We are frustrated because we have some of the most competent scientists in biotechnology. We have some of the best laboratories. We actually have a major training program in Makerere funded by the World Bank, which loan was approved by government and parliament. So it's an absolute contradiction seeing what is happening. People going and deceiving the president. Earlier on, the president was very clear on this thing. And it is important that we listen to the scientists who understand it rather than demonizing them, claiming that they are bought by Monsanto, as if other Ugandans are more patriotic than us. That is not true. Vaccines are generated by technology. When HIV/AIDS was threatening us, and the Americans said, we want to test vaccine against HIV/AIDS. We went through the process and authorized them. And they did research in Entebbe. If you check the process of producing many of those drugs, you'll find that biotechnology is involved. Example, insemination. Are you going to say that because that is an uncalled cattle, you cannot do artificial insemination? The other one is embryo transplant, where you can actually create embryos of the same animal and transplant. Instead of it mating, you get the product you want. Now, instead of bringing animals from Europe, we bring embryos and we put it in our cows, and the cows that we wanted from Europe get born here. So that is the progress of science. Do people know that 90% of banana genes are actually our genes too? So are we bananas? That 99% of the genes that we have, we share with chimpanzees, are we chimpanzees?
So we have it clear from from Professor Ogenga Latigo, and he's saying, human beings have some genes of bananas. It doesn't make us bananas. Human beings have genes from chimpanzees. It doesn't make us chimpanzees. So, Dr. Okia, just break it down for us to understand.
Could I clarify one thing before he jumps on that?
Yes.
He did mention that scientists sometimes confuse people and that food should not be a subject of experimentation. Is Dr. Okia not aware that actually, as I speak to him, is actually 99% chance he's wearing GMO clothes, everything. He's been select in the GMO. 99% of the cotton produced globally is actually GMO
But someone would argue that's cotton. It's not something we're ingesting in the system.
You know?
I don't eat this cooking oil. Yes. And we consume it. In Burkina Faso, people actually just get the seeds and chew them.
Thank you for mentioning
all right,
Burkina
Dr. Okia, yes? Dr. Okia,
so
yes.
A person who is wearing 99% of actually selecting cotton clothes, cotton fabric, everything, that's GMO.
You see, here's the difference. So there are scientists who are concerned about experiments in labs. There are scientists who are concerned about human life.
Yes.
My task is human life. I'm concerned about my
patients. Then let's allow GMO.
You can trivialize and say that because I'm wearing a GMO suit, therefore we should feed the Ugandan public on GMOs.
Now let me give you another example. Let me ask him one example. What did he eat last night? Perhaps bananas.
Okay. I want him
to know that these things are safe as everything. Bananas.
Let me give you one example. Traditional bananas against a law that has strict liability. It's a social responsibility. You can't allow people to die without food. Then let us put a law that has strict liability.
No, gentlemen. Let's talk about safety issue first.
If it is safe,
let's finish with safety.
Doctor Okia, one person at a time. Let Dr. Okia finish his point.
Nature invests a lot in protecting DNA. Mm-hmm. It is very, very difficult to access it. In fact, nature hides DNA safely inside the nucleus, the most hidden part of the body, that no one may touch it. What these gentlemen do, they invade that DNA, the cell, open it up, and then use different mechanisms like a gun to shoot DNA and force it into what nature was, never intended to be. When you destabilize DNA, yes, you cause a lot of risks. One thing that destabilizes DNA, for example, is radiation. You can see Fukushima, Hiroshima, where there was radiation exposure, DNA got destroyed. And the result is cancer, the result is infertility, people have been exposed to radiation, you find developed tumors. That is the risk. We're saying don't tamper with our food supply. Uganda is a world leader in organic food. Yes, we have a potential market over $500 billion of organic food is sold. Yes.
Right.
Now by contaminating our food supply and contaminating our soils with these GMOs, we are risking financial disaster, economic disaster. It is not true that we need these GMOs. There are so many things we have not explored in improving our agriculture.
Okay, Mr. Klett, what exactly pushes you? Is it the economics and what this will mean for the economy? Is it the money? What exactly is pushing you towards making sure that Uganda actually embraces GMOs?
The GMO technology is a progression of technologies. And if you want to actually appreciate a progression of technologies, just look at the phone. It started with some big, small thing performing one or two functions. It has now advanced into this, so you can literally perform anything, send email, use it as an office or anything. Progression of technology. Traditionally, people would just select, go in the wild, select what works for them, began cultivation,
mm-hmm.
then they started crossing those that are good, then eventually it progressed like that. Now it gets to a time where you can actually speed up that process using the genetic engineering tool.
But
so it's simply a progression.
Is it natural?
No, that is not true.
You see, things that happen in nature are mixed. Let me tell you one thing again.
Mm-hmm.
You see this kind of not telling the truth or being honest to ourselves, where someone can claim that, you see, organic foods in Uganda are almost $500 billion.
I said
the
global market.
In Uganda here, the statistic shows that only the total organic exports is $50 million. And when you put together the entire non-organic market from agricultural produce, is well over $1 billion. So in terms of economics, we are not getting anywhere wrong. We are on the right track.
I said the global market for organic.
Yes, but now
over
I've clarified the fact that yes, in Uganda it's only $50 million
uh-huh.
total. as compared to 1 billion of non-organic exports. So in terms of economics, don't even go there. But in terms of safety, I can assure you that there is no any other crop that has been assessed for safety other than the GMOs. He cannot tell us, unless if he's telling us, World Health Organization and all the experts in there are actually quack.
Dr. Klett, is this a matter of controlling the food basket of
the country? Actually, when it comes to food, we have exchanged germplasm left, right. Bananas, for example, did you know that they came from Honduras? Bananas were not an indigenous crop to Uganda or Africa. They came from there. Maize came from Mexico. Right now, what the people call local maize here was bred by an Indian based in Mexico for 30 years. That maize is now called Nalongo and Salongo on Ugandan market. People now say it is our indigenous, but was bred for a period of 30 years by an Indian based in Mexico. Potatoes, cassava, all this came from Latin America. Rice came from Asian countries. So there's nothing indigenous other than millet, sorghum, those are indigenous crops here, and some species of yams.
Okay.
But most of the food that we consume never originated here. Did you know that wheat, for example, came from somewhere around Ethiopia and the Middle East, then it has spread to other parts of the world? So as scientists, we keep exchanging these things whichever benefits nature.
So what you're saying is that way we have GMOs in the market?
I cannot guarantee they are not there, but what I know, when you go right now on the market, when you go right now on the market, let me complete. When you go right now on the market, you find there are GMO products. They actually clearly mark this product contains GMOs. Go and look at the cornflakes that we eat every other day.
But of course,
they are definitely
the
very
They are not even marked.
Okay.
Yes?
They are marked. I challenge you to go to any supermarket, selling cornflakes,
the only
and
ones
try
that are
to
marked
check.
Are the ones that don't have GMOs. Someone will put and say, this one does not have GMO.
Yes. But of course, most of these things that have GMOs in the shelves are imported from other countries.
And then,
of course, the elite who don't want to buy, oranges with spots, but oranges that are totally orange. Dr. Okia, just break it down for us. When I consume, of course, we're getting views from on the ground, and Andrew Chamagero was actually speaking to most of the people, and they were saying that GMOs don't last because they mature faster, so they're not natural, number one. They actually say that GMOs are not tasty, so it actually defies and removes the rich factors in our foods. The other thing that actually stood out so strongly is that they cannot be replanted. With that in mind, let's get to the health factor, Dr. Okia. Break it down for us. If, as a human being, I consume, for example, tomatoes that have been genetically modified, how will they affect my health directly?
So, again, back to the DNA, yes? There are foods which we're supposed to eat or which our bodies have gotten used to eat. For example, tomatoes and all these kind of things. A GMO is when you mix two different species. For example, you may mix maize with the genetic material of a bacteria or with the genetic material of some other animal that maybe makes the maize resistant to something, yes? So this new thing which you have created is no longer maize. It is maize with the DNA of some other organism, we call now a GMO.
Right.
Yes, your body reacts to such foreign genetic materials with allergies and causes a state of inflammation within the body. And chronic inflammation eventually leads to diseases. We now know that heart disease is a result of chronic inflammation. Possibly diabetes also a result of chronic inflammation. And that is the risk we're talking about. Mm-hmm. We're saying you are poisoning the food supply and feeding it to the public, which eventually we as medical practitioners have to suffer to sort out.
So in your view, we should not even think about this conversation
we
as a
should
country.
Stay away from food. My friend has talked about we use biotechnology in so many ways to produce insulin, to produce vaccines. Yes, let them invest their efforts in that, but we must not put at risk these the innocent farmer who does not understand the implications, who does not know what happens to the soil when he starts using some of the chemicals associated with GMOs, and who is then stuck. Yes, and that is why we're saying we need a law that has strict liability. We need a law that protects our farmers. We need a law that in case anything goes wrong, these scientists and their funders will be held responsible.
All
we're saying.
Mr. Klett, I know that you are always in touch with farmers on the ground, and for them the conversation has been, how do we increase our yields, return on investment? So are farmers pro GMOs? What is the conversation on ground?
we are addressing the constraints that the farmers are faced with.
But are they among them?
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm. Go to the, forget about these street people that have been picked on the street who understand nothing Vincent, about seed production.
Let me just make it clear.
These are not farmers. These are not farmers. When you go to the real farmers on the ground.
Dr. Mr. Klett, let me make it clear. Andrew Chamagero was speaking to farmers. In that lot, there were farmers. There were market people who are vendors who sell fresh produce.
Thank you.
And this
Thank
is feedback,
you.
Holistic
Thank
feedback.
You. Thank you.
Let me finish.
Let me give,
from
yes.
the clients as well, from the consumers, from the customers, and from the farmers
nobody
as well.
Wants so these
nobody
GMOs.
Wants nobody the GMOs.
Nobody wants them.
The farmers don't want them.
If that concept is true,
it is only
Doctor, give me a second. If that concept is true, allow us have the GMO on the market. We shall, the customer is a farmer and the consumer. We shall actually see who actually doesn't need these things. Because tell me a farmer who has planted cassava and lost the entire crop due to cassava brown streak. You tell me that those farmers are happy to make losses 100%? Tell me about the farmer who is infected with banana bacterial wilt, where the entire garden has wilted. You tell me that that farmer doesn't need this product.
So this conversation is about the coin at the end of the day. It's about
It's not
money.
About that. It's even the safety
Thank
has
you.
Been assessed
it's about
and
money.
They have been found to be very safe. You talked about allergies. There are people who are naturally allergic to certain substances. For example, I'm allergic to sulfurs. If I take anything that has sulfurs, like septrin, codicap, my body will develop blisters. For as a result, I have to use some as a medicine. Not as, then talk about things to do with nuts. There are some people who are allergic to nuts.
Okay.
Gluten, for example.
All
so
right.
it's not, and when you are assessing the safety of GMOs, you bring the conventional, non-conventional, test it. If there is no significant difference between the two in terms of safety, in terms of the nutrients, that's when it is released to the environment.
All right, gentlemen.
So all is telling us are lies. They are not based on any scientific facts.
Okay. Gentlemen, let's get now fresh views from the ground. Andrew Chamagero actually has questions for you. Andrew, if you can hear me, feel free to shoot.
Malo, thank you so much. A couple of opinions are still here. Sebo, I need to use your mommy, Masiga.
Junior, do gracias. Sebo, you're going to use your Masiga, and ever. And ever. So, my Masiga, Chukwebaza, Webali Kuja, Nakuza, Kateka. But not to go to the house. Nino kwa chakula vila kwa kawanda. Kawanda, imazemi yako nizijigenda mkada. Ngekolo kuno onyeleza. Buli nsigo jeno onyeleza ako, tuwabede tulogoza, tukua kusawa ya lero. Tuinawe nsigo, ikakasi duwanti yoye inoko okusimbiwa. Na ye, basimbia mwogo, okuvalu vata andika. Nukutusa kusawa ya wachalita mwogo mpya. Mwogo vatulisa wangerichi. Edatu inawe sige chinti, ebintuwe vatulisa, tibikole vulawe mblambuwa.
I'm going to go to the house. Nega doli mawe mwaka gumu, oguo kubiri, ngetaka. Terija asobola kukola chiku, kulaba chirimeo chonga chikola chichidao. Oli mwabutuno mwaka gumu, buwabu zao, buwabu tukagurubu kala mkazi.
Aiva na nechu mwuzo za mwami masiga?
Yee.
Mwuzi mwuzi.
Nize sija kumwoni wa mwami masiga. Nize President Museveni ni gwanga ni alimpamwe wikisibiri. Oyo muteka karaba.
Karaba hati.
Rubusungu, tuweza kutila kwa mtu omu, oteba nansibo na.
Well, well. Well, there you have it, Mala and Mr. Masiga. Those are the questions from the ground. It's still about the GMOs. The wrath is overwhelming.
Thank you so much, Andrew Chamagero, for those concerns. Gentlemen, it's real. People do not want GMOs. Dr. Okia, as you come to a close, 1 minute each.
Okay. The final point I want to make is what this gentleman was talking about.
Right.
One of the common ways to modify plants is to give them a genetic trait that makes it resistant against certain poisons, in particular a poison called glyphosate. What that does, it means that this plant can resist poison. So what you do, you go and poison your field, yes, and then you plant this GMO and it will grow and nothing else will grow, which means you don't have to weed. But the poison remains in your field, yes. And for a long time, people claim this thing is harmless. It is organic. It has now been shown it is not only not organic, yes, most likely it is a carcinogen, it causes cancer. Now, honestly, why on earth do you want to take a poison, yes, and pour it across the countryside in the name of promoting some kind of science,
right?
Yes, you're putting the lives of Ugandans at risk. And I really appeal to my fellow scientists. We cannot risk the future of our people
all
by
right.
poisoning their soils. Thank
okay.
you.
Mr. Klett,
yeah.
1 second.
GMOs have been consumed for over 20 years now. And there's no single trace that they have not been safe. More than 4 billion people in the world consume GMOs on a daily basis. When it comes to glyphosates, or what people call mainly Roundup, or weed killers, glyphosate is much safer than atrazine. I have been studying the chemical consumption in the market here. When you go to Container Village, the consumption of this chemical is now 5 million liters every year. Now, the people who are funding work against GMOs mm-hmm. are funding because they want to promote business for agrochemicals, and none of them is Ugandan. Many Europe, Asian countries, and that is where the cause is, because
okay.
the farmers consume these chemicals. What we are doing with GMOs is to reduce the consumption
right.
of these chemicals.
Okay.
So I tell the people, this is a safe product. All we are doing is a natural social justice issue. Let's allow our Ugandan farmers, like their counterparts in developed countries,
right.
to have access to technology.
So do we all in unison agree that the only solution is that before Parliament and the government actually approves this, we need to have a case study and actually do something?
No, studies are done.
Let us do a study.
Yes.
Since we are claiming
which
to be scientists,
which studies is thinking about?
Let us do a study.
We do these studies.
We get 20 Ugandan
before any material is natural, is commercialized.
All
we can do, we put that into the law, a clause in the law which says this is how analysis should be
done. I need a yes or a no. Do we do a study, a fresh one, just for Ugandans? Yes or a no?
Ugand is not unique.
Okay.
Science.
Yes, absolutely.
All right. We have to come to a close. We actually need to have this conversation again with your views, of course. And this time round, if we can do it bigger, some of you coming in studios, it will be very important for us to have that conversation. Very important. That has been it for Solutions segment. Keep your views coming. The hashtag is morning at NTV. You can also stream us live and drop in your comments. NTV Uganda. That's on Facebook and YouTube pages. Morning at NTV still continues. Up next is Take Notes with Flavia Tumusime. Keep it here.